Hello and welcome. This is Rasheem, and we are having the HBCU after show live and in full effect. I hope that someone else joins me. Tashi's in the room. Tashi, if you want to join, click the little camera at the bottom. Damon, I see you're here. If you want to join in, click the little camera at the bottom. So this is just the HBCU after show. We had a really good show, really good comments. Seven different HBCUs represented amongst, you know, four individuals, whether people went to two different HBCUs or they went to one. We talked about the good, the bad, and the not so good, you know what I mean? A little bit of rivalry amongst the HBCUs, but at the end of the day, it is all good and it's all love. And I definitely, again, appreciate everybody who showed up. So if you did miss it, and you want to watch it, the way that you would be able to watch it on, let's say, YouTube is it will be listed under Exploring the Legacy and Legitimacy of HBCUs. If you want to watch it, okay. If you want to watch it and you're watching this channel, it'll probably be somewhere in the feed. You can also visit shavillarasheem.com. And you'll be able to watch all of the different replays. I see Damon is here. Damon, if you want to jump on the camera, I'll let you in right after Tashi gets on. And I see, oh, that didn't work out. So let me try Damon now. And then I'm going to try to see about letting Stephanie in the room and see how that works on. Okay. Tashi says, hold on for a sec. And she'll be right with us. But yeah, it was a good show. We talked about the F word in HBCUs, you know, financial aid. Y'all know how it is. We also talked about the other F word, the actually good one, which is family and fictive kinships that really make that experience meaningful and unique and deep for us, and about how we learn not just academically, but we also learned about a sense of self. Damien shared a lot about, you know, how he developed a greater sense of self in his experience. We also talked about Greek life. And for those of us who have experienced it directly, some people have experienced it indirectly, what that means, what that looked like. Some of our first exposures to what HBCU was. We talked about the history of it. What exactly does HBCU mean? What is the difference between HBCU and a traditionally white institution? And I'm actually trying to get people on, but having a little bit of technical challenges. But those are some of the things that we talked about in the main shows. One of the things I feel like I'm really interested in talking about in the after show is I really want to talk a little bit more about some of those other influences. I want to talk about the guidance counselor who might have talked to us and encouraged us to go to school. I even want to talk about Drumline. What was, you know, even if Drumline wasn't a direct, influence on you going. Because it wasn't, I was already in undergrad when Drumline came out. But one of the things that I appreciated is about seeing my story or aspects of my story actually being told on a big screen. And that's another thing that I will say that I also appreciate about a different world. At that point, it wasn't my story, but what I got to see with a different world is I got to see diversity among Black people for one of the first times, and diversity among educated Black people. So you had Freddie, you had Whitley, you had Dwayne Wayne, you had all of these different Black people that were all educated, but all different. They were all diverse. And that was one of the first times that I had seen that. And Tashi come on here looking like a glamour girl. I don't got time for that. You know what I mean? I don't got
because
time.
Because today is my day of the day. Today is my show day. I do two shows. That's why.
So what was your HBCU otherwise experience?
So mine is probably a little bit different, but similar to those who went to an HBCU for undergrad, because my HBCU experience was grad. So I did my master's and PhD at Howard. And so undergrad, I was at a PWI. So it's a completely different experience when you go to an HBCU for graduate school than for undergrad. So, you know, part of the thing is like, you could identify my first semester in the master's program, all my classes got purged. I was like, what the hell is this? But you have to understand, I was so excited to be at Howard University that I didn't care. I had had such a time of it at the University of Buffalo that I was ready for something else, and come hell or high, whatever, I don't care, purge all my classes, they'll find a way for me to get them back. So it was fantastic. And I always tell people that my graduate experience was more like, to me, my real college experience, what my undergraduate should have been.
Yeah. And I noticed there was probably some, I'm imagining there was quite a bit of comparing, and probably it was probably some challenges around when, so if a person comes from undergrad and they just had 4 years of dealing with missing paperwork and all of that, as opposed to if you've gone to a school and they run squeaky clean and then you go to this other institution, I'm sure that I'm imagining there had to be some times where you was like, what in the world is going on?
Well, here's the thing. It may have run squeaky clean. By the way, I really didn't have like financial aid problems or anything when I was at Howard, and I'll talk about that after. So it may have run squeaky clean at the University of Buffalo, but I also didn't have to see the N-word scrawled in a desk when I went to Howard either. So I got tired of being a Black student. I just wanted to be a student. And Howard allowed me to be that scholar that I could not be at the University of Buffalo because I was constantly bombarded with other racial things.
Now tell me, when you were at, so you had your undergrad experience at a PWI and your graduate experience at HBCU. Mm-hmm. When you were at the PWI, did you ever have to be or feel a pressure to be like representative of the race or a spokesperson for the race?
I was the president of the campus NAACP, yes. So, you know, I got very involved in a lot of things because, well, first of all, I really did not want to be there. That was not my first choice. But since I was there, I said, all right, let me make the best of it. So I got involved in a lot of things. Of course, I was a member of the BSU. Then we started the NAACP, and I was the president of the NAACP for 2 years. So really, when anything ever went down on campus, people came to me. And you definitely are the representative, and you are the face of Black. The BSU and the NAACP were like really the face of Black people on the campus. Not so much the CSA, because that was more of a cultural organization. But when it came to issues, yeah, it was the two of us. And you get tired of always having to be like, you can't, I came here to go to school. You know, I can't focus on going to school because of all these other things. And that was so not the case at Howard University. Granted, I was there for graduate school, but I was also very involved there. So I was part of the African Student Association. I was the public relations person for them. I was also part of the WHBC, our student radio station. I was assistant program director there. So I got really involved, even though I was a graduate, because I felt this is real college to me. So I got involved.
That's what's up. So tell me a little bit more about, so you were in the BSU, and you also did the president of the NAACP on campus. Was your relationship or experiences with Black people different, with the Black student body different on a white campus than it was on a Black campus? Or was it just, you know, the same? Was there any difference?
You know, here's the thing. And it probably is not a fair thing. So University of Buffalo, while it's a large research institution, it drew a lot of people from New York State. So you're going to have mostly people from New York State. And even though regions of New York are different, it still is a very different feel than when you're going to an institution where you've got people from all 50 states and internationally. And so it's different. You've got different types of Black people, whereas at University of Buffalo, you had Black people. And so it was a completely different experience, I think. So there were some things that were similar and some things that were not quite the same, simply because of where they were and the types of institutions and the fact that you had people from so many different places at Howard, whereas you basically really just had New York State and some international people at the University of Buffalo.
Were you Greek?
I'm Greek.
Which sorority are you with?
Delta Sigma Theta.
Delta! Yeah. You know, I mentioned before, I'm not Greek, but I always find my best girlfriends are Deltas. I don't know.
But of course, we're awesome.
They are some of my best girlfriends. So when you, I'm always curious too, to hear about, like one of the questions that I asked them, what went into your decision? You had already had the 4-year experience with a PWI. What was it that informed your decision that made you decide, I want to go to HBCU for grad school?
For grad school. Well, my intention was to go to Howard University for undergraduate. And I just held on to that dream. And my mother was, huh?
Everybody trying to get into the Mecca.
Yes. Yeah. Well, I had always, you know, wanted to go there. I did not know, first of all, in high school, I did not know really a lot about HBCUs. Obviously, New York State doesn't have any HBCUs. The closest one is Lincoln in Pennsylvania. And so that's not something that's on the radar until I went to an HBCU fair and they happened to let the area high schools know. And I said, really? And I went to all the, I was like, Harris Stowe? Talladega? What are all these colleges? I had never seen such a thing before. And so I got as many applications as I could. And something about Howard's booklet just kind of stood out to me. And I said, I think I'd like to try Howard University. And so that was my thing. But in terms of it was being tired. I want to be a student and not a Black student. I already know I'm Black. I don't need you to tell me and remind me every 5 minutes. And it's tiring to constantly think about race. Now that doesn't mean you don't think about it and you don't realize, obviously in a graduate program at an HBCU, there's going to be a lot of critical race theory. There's going to be a lot of Afrocentricity and Malefia Sante. You know this is going to be the case, but you're looking at it from a critical perspective and because you want to, not because you're forced to deal with it because of who you are. So I was tired of seeing it, and I at the end I was just like, to hell with all of you, I'm going to Howard. And I exhaled as soon as I got to DC. I exhaled.
It's probably more your difference. It's probably more noticeable when you're in an atmosphere where everybody's different from you. And it could probably, I could see how that would be exhausting. Whereas if you're in an area where everything is familiar, it's not like me being a Black woman is constantly on my mind when I'm talking to another Black woman, right? But I could see exactly on my mind when I'm the only Black woman in the room and it's all white men.
Exactly. And, you know, another thing that was refreshing, you know that I'm also Nigerian. And there is a trailer load of Nigerians that go to Howard University. So, you know, it was a no-brainer to join the African Student Association and do those types of things. And it's nice to be around culturally people that are like you as well. So number one, on the level of being Black was great. Number two, on the level of meeting other Nigerians, because Buffalo didn't have a large number of Nigerians. So they have some, but not a large number. So it was great to be around a critical mass, I would say.
Being around a lot of Black people.
Yeah. You know what I think the problem is for people? What you have to do is when she calls you in, you've got to enlarge the screen. So the arrows in the bottom right-hand corner, if you click on it, it makes it full screen. That way you can get to the button to accept, because it blocks it if you don't. That's what I figured out. So you're trying to get in and you can't. It's like, it's not letting me in. So if you make the screen full size, and then, yeah, so make it full size, click on the accept, and that should help you.
Let's see if that helps.
Or not.
We got 20 seconds to see if it works for Darnell. No, I mean, I think that's important to mention. Like, I think sometimes when I get around some people, I think that there is a shift. And it's not necessarily code switching so much it is some level of adapting to, like, whether it's adapting to my environment or I'm just going to use the language that you understand. sometimes when I speak, I let people know, I say to them, I have a few degrees, but I'm still a little Black girl from the South who was raised by a single mother. And I know that that little Black girl from the South who was raised by a single mother is not as popular as the educated married woman that's standing in front of you right now. But I owe it to the little Black girl to speak and share her story. So you might hear some of her story, but don't worry, I'm going to use some of your language, but I'm also going to use some of hers. And I feel like it's important for me to say that, because I do feel like I need to speak for her. I do owe that to her, to that little Black girl, to speak. So as I, you know, or sometimes I'll say, yeah, as I talk, you might hear some big words, like big and words, but you also may hear some African-American vernacular English.
I like that vernacular.
Do not attempt to adjust your screen or your audio. What's up, Darnell?
What's up? I didn't know I was going to be, hold on. I didn't know I was going to be seen. Wait. Put my light on. Okay.
Yeah, I can see you.
Okay. Good.
One of the things that I was just asking Tachi was about her experience, because she went to a PWI for her undergrad, but then she went to HBCU for graduate experience. And I know you had two different, you had PWI and HBCU, right?
Slightly. I did some work at UVA, at University of Virginia.
Okay. So I'm curious about in those other spaces where, you know, we used to be in a minority, but in some spaces are you, or even now, actually, now that you've graduated and you're part of the talented 10th, are you called on to be like the representative for your race? Do you have to be the spokesperson? Are you the magical Negro?
Yeah, I think, yeah, it happens a lot. Especially like I live out here in Los Angeles. I work in the entertainment industry, which is a lot of, it's not Black. It's not a Black industry. It's not a Black space. Most of the spaces I'm in, I'm the only Black person. I've been in an office where I was the only Black person on between maybe five floors, you know? And so there are a lot of times when I have to be, oh, let's get the Black opinion on what's happening, or how do Black people feel about this? And then, but unless something Black happens, then no one wants to know.
So
know your opinion, you know, like I was working for a network here when the George Zimmerman trial was going on. It was the quietest workplace, but me sitting there in my cubicle with the sound all the way up on the trial, like, you know, we all about to hear this, you know, like that's what it is. So they want your opinion until they think it may be something else, you know what I mean?
Yeah, no, I get that. I'm still, sometimes I think I'm in a Black academic bubble, Tachi, because I automatically assume people know stuff. Like, I automatically assume people know what HBCU is.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. As well, you should, but history has proven that most people don't. I mean, I'm just appalled when some people are, oh, Howard, where is that? What do you mean, where is Howard? Not the Mecca. You do not know where the Mecca is? How dare you? Yeah, but yeah, no, it really is a high context thing that we assume everyone knows where, you know, not to talk of Howard, when you talk about something like Harris Stowe or some of the, they really don't know then unless they happen to live in those regions. So yeah, you expect them to, but the society is not created for the alternative, quote unquote. It's designed around the mainstream. So they don't have to know all of our institutions. Mm-hmm. They are not required to know what Delta Sigma Theta is. That's why when they ask, I'm like, what do you mean you don't know what Delta is? They're not required to know that.
But you know, what's funny about that, like what you just said, I went to Bethune-Cookman, and right behind the school is a gas station. And I remember my freshman year, it was a white guy, and he's like, oh, you're a student here? I'm like, yeah. He's like, you go to Daytona Beach Community College? I'm like, no, I go to Bethune-Cookman. He's like, where's that? I'm like, right here. It's right behind this gas station. He's like, oh. I was like, yeah, it's a historically Black college. He's like, I never knew that was there. And he's from Daytona.
And, I'm like, and let me put this into some context. Daytona is this big.
And it's that big, and it's very segregated. So the side of town that Bethune is on is very black. So the fact that you've seen a white man in that gas station was, like, oh, you're on this side of town. Yeah, we were both shot.
So what's up, Steph?
Hi, how's everyone? Hi, Tachi. Hi, Darnell. Nice.
Hey. Hello.
So this is a very interesting topic to me, because there are a lot of people who have graduated from historically black universities. And my grandmother talked to me about, you know, being black and education and things like that. That's why I was very aware of historically black schools and things like that. And then, of course, my mom went to Texas Southern, my dad, my stepdad, my grandpa went to Tuskegee. You know, I have a slew of cousins that went to Prairie View, and they have PhDs, they're law professors. One of them just got tenured. A friend of mine just is a director of nursing at a major hospital here that went to Prairie View. So now I have friends that went to PV as well. And then I also have another sector of black friends that went to Texas A&M. And so it's like, it's very interesting sometimes. I will say that I had my heart set on going to Morgan State. I think I told you this, Rasheem, when I went on this black college tour, but my mom was like, fuck no, you're not going all the way to Baltimore. Like, you're not going that far.
Not so, only a little bit.
Just a little bit.
A little bit. And that was back in, so I didn't have a perception that Baltimore was dangerous or anything like that. I mean, because it was my first time on the East Coast. I think we visited 10, maybe 12 schools. Like, we did a lot. So then I thought, well, I want to be a pharmacist and I want to go to Xavier. And it's in New Orleans. And my mom felt a little bit better about that because it's driving distance from Houston, 6 hours. Mm-hmm. And then right before I graduated, my grandmother died. And my mom is an only child, and my mom clung to me. She did not want me to leave. It was so when the other lady got a little bit emotional about having to alter her course for her college plans, I could really relate to how she felt, mm-hmm. because I ended up going to a primarily white school because my mom was so attached to me, and she had just lost her mother. So and I was miserable. My first year, I was just miserable. I was unmotivated, and I'm a self-motivated person. Like, I'm the type of kid that my mom never even checked my report card because she already knew my grades were good. Like, she never even looked at it, really. So that first year was really, really hard. Huh?
Is when this topic comes up for you about HBCUs and stuff like that, is it a bit bittersweet because you feel like you missed out?
There's a turning point in this story, and I said, I'm not going here anymore, and I transferred to Prairie View the next year. And my mom's like, I don't even think I told her I was gonna do it. I just did it. And I was like, okay, well, like that summer, I'm like, well, I'm not going back. And then I went there, and then I was like, it was so hard because I didn't have a car, and it was in the middle of nowhere, and I needed money because, you know, my mom supports me, helping me pay my tuition and things, but I struggled because at that time, Prairie View isn't as developed as it is now. This is almost 20 years ago, and I struggled financially, and I thought, you know, okay, well, maybe I should go back. So I really had a hard time trying to figure out my place in school. And I just, my friends that were able to go to a black college and, you know, go all the way through, I really envy that experience because the little bit of time that I had there and all, you know, I saw the struggles, I saw the crying, you know, the sadness when, like, my friend who's now a director of nursing, she failed a class in nursing school and she had to, it delayed her graduation. It was so sad. Like, and I just, but I feel like the professors were so tough on them and it made them better people. Mm-hmm. And at the school that I was at, U of H, at University of Houston, nobody gives a damn about you. Like, I don't do well trying to learn a very difficult subject. Like, organic chemistry and there's 300 people in the class. I'm the person in the front row. I'm that nerdy person in the front row. I need to make eye contact with the professor. I need you to know who I am. You know, like that's the kind of experience that I thrive in. So it was very hard for me. So I did end up transferring back and I ended up, you know, I graduated and all that stuff, but I really wish I had that experience. And then, you know, I'm sorry if I'm talking too long, but I have another set of a little bit more bougie friends that went to Texas A&M. They're still my girls, but you know, I you still end up hanging with the Black people. There were 101 people in that freshman class at Texas A&M. Do you know how big that school is? 100 Black people. Just 101 Black people matriculated that year. And probably 50 of them ended up graduating because of the way people drop out and, you know, do things like that. So it's just like, you know, so their experience is like, well, you know, ain't that many Black people, you know. So to talk about that, Texas A&M has a very powerful Black outreach program, and they would come to the high performing schools and say, well, we're going to take you to this overnight trip. You're going to stay in the dorm with somebody that graduated with you, and you're going to get this fun experience and to try to recruit Black people. But the admission standards are so high that a lot of Black kids are not able to get in. So it's very interesting. And then also the thing about Texas is that if you graduate in the top 10%, you get automatic admission into a Texas school. Hmm. And so even though, so if you're in a, so percentage is very difficult when you go to a very rigorous school like the one that I went to, and there's only 139 people in your graduating class. To be in the top 10% is very different from going to a very less than rigorous school and there's 800 kids graduating. So people that I went to school with that never took calculus are getting into very difficult schools like UT just based off of the fact that they graduated in the top 10%.
So tell me,
and their GPA is significantly lower than mine.
So tell me, especially with like,
I can't hear you. I think your mic is covered.
How about now?
Okay.
Still hear an echo.
Oh, hello? Maybe it's me.
You got some headphones?
Hold on.
It's going now.
Oh, okay.
So here's a question that I have, Tasha. I'm gonna throw it at you first. With the experience that you had at your graduate level, with where you were at HBCU, what are some things that you feel like that they could do outside of the, you know, you said your financial aid went well, fantastic. Outside of administratively, what are some ways in which that you think that HBCUs can do better? Like, where can we improve the college experience? Where can we improve academically? How can we graduate more students? How can we attract more students?
You know, that's like really a loaded question, because there are so many aspects to that, because then it's like also looking at, do we ask these same questions of the PWIs? And the retention of students at PWIs is probably not worse than the retention of students at HBCUs. So it's like, are we asking these same questions of PWIs? And I don't think we do. And I'm speaking as having not only attended PWIs and HBCUs, but being a faculty member at PWI, two HBCUs, and one Hispanic serving institution. So I have a broad, you know, wealth of knowledge in terms of that. So in terms of what can HBCUs do, and I'm just speaking from my experience, because I saw a lot of the same things going on. If we're not talking about administratively, I saw a lot of the same things going on. I think a lot of what holds people to HBCUs is the campus culture. You know, there's a campus culture that's there that is unparalleled by some other place. And not to say that there is not, there's definitely campus culture at places like University of Alabama and University of Florida. There's definitely a campus culture, you know, obviously, but it's unparalleled in terms of the depth of what that means to a student. So I think really doing things like reaching out to the same top performing schools, making it, and this, showing up, because I also live in Florida. I live in South Florida, and I have been trying to get a friend of mine, her son is going to college, and I'm like, I really want you to consider an HBCU, but I wanted them to consider an HBCU outside of Florida, because what happens is Florida students generally tend to stay in Florida. Now, that's the same with a lot of states, but for some reason here, they really stay. So I'm like, if you can find a way just so that he gets another worldview, let him go to school outside of Florida and then come back. So one thing that had, there was a supposed to be when the Urban League had their conference here in Fort Lauderdale, there was a college fair. Do you know half of those HBCUs did not show up? So I need us to be there and be present when it comes to the recruiting efforts of it, and not be lazy and not be slack about it, because be for damn sure all the local Florida schools were there, but the HBCUs, the Morehouses and whatever, were not there. Now, I don't know what happened, but she said, this is the second time I've come to something and they've not been there. Now, that is not representative of how they always do, not saying that, but we've got to do a better job. Recruitment is the lifeblood, the lifeline for us, recruitment and retention. So we got to get them in the door. And then we have to make their experience awesome while they're there, so that they'll not only want to stay and finish, but they'll also want to give back.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Awesome.
Darnell? Yeah, I mean, I completely agree with that. I think just speaking on the recruitment and the retention, I think that, you know, a lot of times we hear that HBCUs can compete with PWIs, and I think if we seriously want to compete, then we need to compete. We need to show up, and we need to do these things. Like, it's not hard to take a model that works from another school and use that. And I think a lot of times we have HBCUs that have so much pride that we don't want to take a PWI model. You know, sometimes we don't even want to take another HBCU model. But I think that if we're going to say that we are competitive and that a degree from wherever, from Hillman College, is just as good as a degree from anywhere else in the world, then we need to step up and make it that way and make sure that the people we're recruiting want to be there and the people that we are retaining want to be there. We had homecoming a couple years ago, and we had just had it was a huge riot broke out on campus, the whole thing. On the news, it was on YouTube, everything. It was between a group of guys from Jacksonville and a group of guys from Miami. And, you know, once we all got to the campus, they took me and my fraternity brothers, because at the time the vice president was a Kappa as well. So he called a conference with us. He's like, you need to step in and mentor these young men. And he had this step-by-step program of what he wanted to do for the young men on campus who were involved in the fight or who were at high risk for doing things like that. And my first thing was, well, maybe we need to start looking at the admissions office and who's recruiting these young men, because that's where it really needs to start. It doesn't need to start once we get them in here. It needs to start before we get them in. So I think that's a big thing. Looking back over our recruitment policies and our strategies and approaches and seeing where we can go from there.
Yeah, that's definitely a thing. Mm-hmm. One of the things that thanks for subscribing, Jay. One of the things that I feel like I've noticed is I'm feeling like presidents are feeling pressure not to be HBCU. So what does diversity look like, and what exactly does it mean within the context of HBCU? Tachi, I'll let you start with that.
Who's that?
Tachi?
Okay.
Oh, me. Okay. So here's the thing, depending on what HBCU you're talking about, there's always been diversity at HBCUs. And I think we fall into this trap of only thinking that diversity means ethnicity and race, and it goes so far beyond that. I can recall teaching at HBCUs that I not only had people from all over the world, and but people from different states, people from different neighborhoods if they were local, having people with disabilities. That's another thing we don't look at. So there's always been a level of diversity. Now, if you're wanting to talk about, so are you asking what needs to happen to make it more diverse, or just what diversity
looks
like?
What exactly does it look like? So we're saying maybe this is the start of the question, really.
Do HBCUs need to be culturally?
Is your thing on your left?
Oh, yep. See? Were you on the show where I talked about how my...
Yep. That's why I said it's on your lap, isn't it?
It's a woman problem, Darnell. You probably don't have no problem with this, but when I sit down, my thighs just spread and just take over everything.
That's why I got three pillows. I got a pillow.
Men's thighs stay the same when they sit down. That?
Right on.
That's because you can have them babies. That's why.
Right? And the hips go all over the place. Anyway.
Exactly.
What was I even saying?
You said, what does diversity look like?
Yeah, so what does diversity look like? And do HBCUs need to be racially and culturally diverse?
If you're asking me, do I think that they need to make a concerted effort to go and recruit other people? Not necessarily. I'm just not. I think that these schools have a history. They were founded for a certain reason. Now, there's always been a history of people, whosoever shall come to be educated, come and be educated, regardless of whatever. They were founded with us in mind, but it doesn't mean that's the way it stays. And there are so many people from other places, and they are really diverse. Mm-hmm. I don't think they need to make a concerted effort to do that necessarily. Now, not everybody may feel the same way. They may feel, oh, well, we need to diversify a little bit. Well, it depends on what your definition of diverse is, because I think a lot of them are hell of diverse already. And it's simply because you see a lot of Black faces. Look at that in comparison to all of the universities and colleges that are in the United States and the way they look. Mm-hmm. So you're talking about wanting, to me, it's a foolish way to try and cover up, spreading out resources. So are you saying you'll give us more resources if we're more diverse? Is this the game you're trying to play? So then my answer is no.
The game they're trying to play in Maryland.
And I didn't know you went to Morgan. I was a professor for 2 years at Morgan.
Were you?
I was.
We were recently in a legal battle, not just Morgan, but the HBCUs in this area about how resources are allocated and underfunded. It's like we won, but we didn't win that whole court. You know those symbolic victories that really did nothing though. But anyway, don't get me on my soapbox. Okay, go ahead, Darnell.
I feel you.
I think for HBCUs, diversity really means like culture. It's a culture thing. Like, you know, you have, just speaking of retention, going back to retention, you have at these PWIs where just because we're Black doesn't mean we share the same culture. And so you have diversity as far as culture goes. Like, I had friends whose parents were sending them baklava and cheese, you know, and it was like, this is different. Okay, so among these Black faces, you find, you know, a great number of things that you are not aware of. You learn more, and again, you learn more about yourself through these people, look like to these folks. And so I think that's what it really means on a HBCU campus. But then you also have like the golf team and the baseball team, and who not one Black person is on there, and so they add into that. But then you were saying, you know, just because it was started for us doesn't mean it's going to stay that way, because you have schools like Bluefield. I think Bluefield College in West Virginia, they're 93% White.
Yes,
that's an HBCU, and you know, it's like, what happened there? You know what I mean? But nobody's going to West Virginia to get educated. We're not going up there. So you know, and because it becomes a very local thing. But that's what I feel diversity is on HBCU campus.
So I want to go to Steph with this. Steph, oh, hold on. It's probably, y'all can probably can't hear because it was just down there. Okay.
Can I say one thing about diversity?
Mm-hmm.
So I think, just quickly, I think diversity starts at the most basic level, and that's diversity of thought. And we all just don't think the same way. And so that affects everything we do culturally, you know, the way we relate to people, the way that we, you know, solve problems, you know, that, and I, working in corporate America, they're always doing this quote unquote diversity training. But if you pay attention to it, some of it's very interesting. The way that people look at diversity, like Tachi was saying, it's more than just through the ethnic racial lens. They talk about, you know, diversity of, you know, geography and, you know, communication styles, just different things like that. I just wanted to point that out and agree with Tachi.
That's what's up. I agree. I agree that there's multiple ways of being diverse, even within the Black community, because like you mentioned, Darnell, there is different culture. Like, you know what I mean? There's different, like, language, countries. There's a multitude of difference. Like, I mean, I could go on for days because a lot of time I'm hit with that question. I focus a lot on Black women in my research. And one of the things is like, why do you just like, that's so narrow, Black women. It's like, oh, like, no, like there's education of Black women. There's Black women in corporate America. There is Black women at different socioeconomic backgrounds. There's Black women who, you know what I mean? Like, come on.
They think we're not like these monolithic groups of people. It's like, okay, like I can focus on Black men and there's still a million things I can talk about. Among them. That's like saying, you know, like Ghana is not a diverse place. Ghana is very diverse. Just everybody happens to be Black. You know?
Right.
Okay. So what was the question you had for me? I'm sorry.
All right. No problem. So I'm going to put this link in just in case. So do y'all remember the read that Roland Martin gave Wendy Williams?
Yes. It was epic.
I don't know if everybody saw it, but if you didn't, can I screen share so we can watch
it? He's from Houston.
Nah, I gotta install it later. I can't do the screen share because I wanted us to watch it together and do like a short
game. I watched that, honey, several times.
So one of the
and after I saw that, I stopped watching Wendy Williams. After I saw that, I refused to watch it. I just can't do it.
Well, so even after, so he came on her show and he educated her and her audience, and she looked extremely, I don't know, embarrassed, humbled, all of those things. Even after you saw him come on her show, didn't feel it? You weren't like, oh, I might start watching her show? Because she was, I felt like she was obviously like, you know, I done stepped in some boo-boo now. You don't mess with Black academics and you don't mess with people with HBCUs. You just don't do it.
I saw the same thing about that alpha, that sorority reality show that came out, and let me tell you, the Black organization stood up and they was like,
oh, we shut that mess down quickly.
That was like, uh-uh, we ain't doing that, not today.
If I ain't never signed a petition before in my life.
But just really quickly, it should not have had to be because it affected a certain elite segment of of Black people. So yeah, I was all over it because I'm like, how dare you make us look bad? But at the same time, I'm like, I wish we could have the same vigor against Love and Hip Hop. I wish we could do the same thing with the rest of these deplorable reality television shows.
Touched. We need to shut down. Basically, you know.
What did you say, Darnell? Say that again.
I said everything that Mona Scott Young has had her hand on.
Shut it down.
I was like, shut it down. I said, she's a serial killer.
Exactly.
She is out here killing Black women, killing the Black
She kids. Is an abomination.
You
yes.
know what I find interesting about this Wendy Williams thing is that I just found that the like you said, she seemed very embarrassed. She seemed really kind of like, okay, I got to eat a little bit of crow or a whole lot of crow. So I watched the clip of her when she made the initial comments. And when I say it was crickets in that audience, that was the indicator, because usually they're right up her ass, you know. you know, agreeing with anything that she says. And I find that Wendy likes to tear down Black women a lot, especially. I see that Black people in general, but she is always tearing down Black women in some of her commentary. And then watching Roland Martin on there school her, I felt it a little disingenuous, her apology, because she had talked about how she had family members who were Black Greek, who had gone to historically Black institutions. So now you pleading, you saying that you're sorry, but you fucking know better. And there are things that even Wendy Williams says, that there's a such thing as kitchen table talk. Even if you believe certain shit, you won't get on TV saying it. I might be All Lives Matter all day, but I'm not going to come in this form and say that. I just wouldn't do it.
Mm-hmm. Unless you don't want hair anymore.
Right. You know, unless
so,
I my edges. You know what I'm saying?
Like, or come in and say blue lives matter.
You, as a Black person, definitely have to know how to move in those types of scenarios where we may hold certain beliefs, but we know when and how to express those beliefs. And you're on a national platform. And even, and to me, when you're on a national platform and Wendy is kind of seen as, like, you know, being accepted by white people at this point, and even when the white people are not wanting to sponsor you because of the comments that you made, you really fucked up.
Well, and if I could speak to that, that's exactly where and I'm not saying she's disingenuous and does not feel genuinely sorry. Yeah. I agree with you, Steph, because her damn mama is an AKA. She knows the history of it. There was probably ski-wee all day around the house. So there's no excuse that she did not know the importance that these organizations played and still continue to play in Black life. That's number one. Number two, you would be boohooing too if one of your biggest sponsors was about to pull the plug. I would eat fried crow all day and cry with mascara running down if that was the case. And that's what it's about. Number three, and Darnell, you can attest to this because you live in LA. I still don't understand why we expect entertainers to be our saviors. She is a gossip columnist. This is what she knows. One thing I know that we need to do is stay in our lane. Simply because you have a national platform does not need to mean you need to use your national platform to speak for me. Because if that's what you have to say, I don't want you speaking for me at all. Don't speak for me. Don't speak for me at all.
That's right.
So, she is an entertainer, and we have to understand that there is a level. Everybody is not a Jesse Williams. Everybody does not have that same level of comprehension and understanding of social situations and economics, etc., to speak on it. So please don't stay in entertainment. Look, read the gossip all day. That is your lane, and you're good at it. But don't speak for Black people.
Exactly.
Right.
And but you know, it's such a crazy thing because although she doesn't speak at all for me, and no celebrity does, and I just won't give them that power. But when I travel, I find that they do speak to other people for us. Like people I just got back from Guatemala. I've been in, when I was in Amsterdam, actually in Norway. People were like, oh, you know, you're the first. I didn't think Black people were like this. You know, I watched so-and-so and I'm like, oh my God. And this is why I tear down Tyler Perry so much, because I know that worldwide he's a representative for Black people. And I just do not like it. So we need to get rid of it all together.
But you know what? Here's the thing in terms of that, looking at that in terms of representation. I don't hate on Tyler Perry only because I do know that those stories exist. And there is room in the space for that. The thing is, we just don't have enough of the counter narrative. There are white all day. Look at this. What is it? The Hangover and all this rubbish where they're acting like bloody fools? Exactly. And they're doing the same thing. The only thing is that there is a counter narrative for them. And so they're not viewed as such, as being stupid frat boys all the time. Maybe by some, but not by the general population. They're not viewed that.
Right. And that's my thing. It's like, we have nothing to counter it. It's like we have Blackish, and then we have everything on VH1, Power, Empire, Tyler Perry, and everything else. And it's like, we have nothing. And so there's nothing, like these stories do exist, but so do other stories. Like we have no normal stories told about ourselves, no normal stories about our lives. And like working in the entertainment industry, these stories don't even get the green light to move forward, which is what's happening. It's like, if I could write a film now that I know would get picked up and I could sell for however much money, but I don't want to write about drugs and black prostitutes and whatever. But as soon as I write another movie like you have Love Jones, which is a fantastic film, and that was the only film that Timothy Witcher created, because he said when he went back to the studio, they told him they didn't want to see any more stories about black love and positive black images, and that's it.
Man, we should have Kente should be in on here. Kente is.
I know. Where is Kente? Kente here.
And he's in the film. So we gotta have a show like that, Darnell. You gonna come and we have a show about that. Yeah, I'm definitely gonna do that. I'm gonna have you, Kente, and I'll probably have an actress. Wait, Tachi, you act, don't you? Aren't you an actress? As well?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
But I'm more of a filmmaker than I am.
Okay, so we gotta do that. Because I think I feel like one of the things that don't get talked about enough. Is there is a politic to storytelling, and the stories that we allow to get told and the things that are getting funded and the things that are getting showed. And I appreciate one of the things that you said, Tachi, in terms of it's not necessarily Tyler Perry himself. Like, we got to have all types of art forms, but if there's only certain ones that you're allowing to get on the screen, you're not telling, you know, you're not
looking. Single story. It's like it's a single story that's being told,
right?
And that's the issue. It's like, it's like a very dangerous thing to do, is just tell one side of the story, because because these stories that Tyler Perry is telling, although they are true, they also help build a society where everybody turns out that way. It's like, I became this person because that's all I saw about black people. And so eventually we, like, now, you know, like a couple years ago when I was growing up, stripping was that was like, oh, you had to drive four towns over if you wanted to be a stripper so nobody would see you. That's like the number one profession now, because we have this single story on television where stripping is a proud job, is a proud profession. You know, that's the dangers of a single story, man.
Right. Nope. That's real. That's very, very real.
But who's buying the single story of Tyler Perry?
Right.
Here's the thing. Mm-hmm. If we were not consumers, these stories would cease to exist. Exactly. That's the thing. Just like any of the reality television shows that we so despise, we are accomplices to our own.
Well, what do you think about? But tell me this: what do you think about the lack of options? If all you put on the table for me is water that has like some dirt in it, and I'm thirsty, I don't have, but I still feel like there should be this thing. We should definitely have a conversation to have more options available.
Absolutely. Well, I feel like there's always options. Again, like when we had this conversation before, I'm like, I'm the last one that's going to sit and tell an actor, well, don't take this role because you have to uplift the race, because I'm not going to go and pay your rent next month when you can't pay it because you don't have a job. So I'm not the one to tell you that.
But you need to be down for the cause. See?
No, I'm not that down for the cause. Anyway, but you know, I'm not going to do that. But at the same time, that's a decision an individual has to make for themselves. And if you can live with that, then that's fine. But that's something that an individual has to make for themselves. But here's the thing. We always constantly think that, number one, I think there is a misnomer that you somehow are automatically going to get rich if you are involved in the entertainment industry. And that's absolute bullocks. No, for everybody that is rich, there are 10 million other fools who are trying to find a way to pay their rent. You do it. Most people are doing it for the love of the field. And if money comes with it, fantastic. But you realize, all right, I have to have something else, or I have to be prepared to live this lifestyle because this is what it is. So I think we have a misconception of how much people in the industry actually make, and that hurts you when you go to get in. Oh, because such and such makes that. That doesn't mean you're going to make it. And I'm not saying don't aim high, but I think you have to be really realistic, especially when you're in an industry where, for all intents and purposes, you are an independent contractor. You're only as good as your current project.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we were having that conversation. Was it? Yeah, it was you, Tati.
Yeah, with Dr. Vibe.
Was it Dr. Vibe on there too? I remember we were having the conversation that we had when we was doing the topic roll. We did the counter.
What was that, Monday night?
It might have been Monday night where we were talking about how Monique got made for Push. Homeboy, who was the star of the Star Wars, the black dude. How much he got paid? Like
John Boyega. Right?
I think it was $100,000.
Like $100,000.
Right. Mm-hmm. And he's like the main character, but all he got was $100,000. But anyway, I think that does put into context in terms of the industry, how much they get made, how much they make, how much power they actually have. One of the things that also came up from that, though, was we talked about what power do, black successful people have, and why aren't people like Denzel, Reading Rainbow dude, Oprah, that's so disrespectful.
LeVar Burton.
I appreciate it.
You don't know Kunta's real name? How dare you?
I'm so jacked up. I remember him being Geordi, right? From Star Trek. But anyway.
Okay, there you go.
So one of the questions that people might pose is, why aren't they getting together then, them and Spike Lee, and creating their own and making a way and getting these films done? Like, what's the conversation behind that? I mean, that might be for the other show, but, you know, just putting it out.
I mean, I think a lot of times, like, just dealing with us, it's about who gets the credit. A lot of it is about who gets the credit. And pride is like, yeah, I got these ideas. Like, I have a million ideas. But as soon as I start looking for a crew, start looking for everything, and it's, one, it's credit. Two, it's no one wants to. People are like, oh, that's a great idea. I think we need to do this. I'm like, okay, let's make it happen. Okay, well, this is how much I'm gonna need. And it's like, listen, I don't have anything. You don't have anything, but if I'm gonna make it, you're gonna make it. And nobody wants to work that way. I mean, you have like Spike Lee, who's made these movies, like the movies he's making now, I don't know. But the movies he used to make, many times he ran out of budget because he didn't have a support system. It was like, he was making, you know, these movies, and he made Malcolm X and even like Oprah and folks who were giving him money originally were like, you're starting to speak against white America. We don't know if we want to give you any more money. So you see Bamboozled, where he shot half the movie with a real budget, and then he had to switch to handheld cameras for the rest of the film. And it's like, oh, because nobody wanted to give money anymore. And but then at the same time, you don't want to speak out because you're like, well, black, you know, I don't want to speak out against black people either. And so it's like, it's a tough position. Like now here in LA, you know, as a filmmaker, like we're starting to tell our own stories and make our own stories. And luckily, like now we're starting to put teams together of people who are like, we all broke and we all trying to make it. And this is what we're going to have to do. We may not make it to the big screen, but we might, who knows, you know, like I did my documentary last year with the cell phone, going through Europe, and I had to learn how to edit, I had to learn how to score, I had to learn how to do all this, because every time somebody said, oh, I want to do this, I'm like, oh, great, but I'm going to need like $1,000 to do it. I'm like, what? No, I don't have it. You know what I mean? So that's what happens.
Yeah, you know, it's really interesting because, and you're seeing it firsthand, Darnell, I think what needs to happen is also a paradigm shift in terms of the platforms we consider for distribution. All of this is happening because we only see mainstream commercial Hollywood as the only, now granted, there may be more of the money and the funding there, but that's not the only place in terms of distribution and exhibition. They just have, of course, a stranglehold on it because it's been for so long. So it comes with a paradigm shift and accepting these new media. I mean, even when you look at a lot of these grants, a lot of them are giving grants for new media projects and using the web, using VR. So I think we need to more creatively look into those areas. The areas where everybody is not necessarily now is where we need to go.
Mm-hmm. That's what's up. I think too, I think one of the things I feel like as you talk, Darnell, that I feel like is, I'm really like, even with this whole podcast video streaming show situation thing that I just randomly started, and randomly started like right after I met Steph, as a matter of fact, you really got to be, and then with the things that I want to talk about, you know, the show's called The Counter Narrative. And I remember having a conversation with this one guy who shall remain nameless. And he just started seeing some of the topics like, what I got over here? Black LGBT, brown and healthy, black educators, black women in corporate America. You know, he's like, I'm noticing it a theme here. And it's a lot about, you know, and I was like, yeah. Mm-hmm. And so, and I think that one of the things that, that I have to be clear on anyway, is my purpose, what it is that I want to accomplish, and the aspect of it that, like, there's aspects of it, like, I'm passionate about this. So I would be like Darnell in a situation where, like, all right, let's go get it done. You know, mm-hmm. like, you know what I mean? Because that's how I feel about it. If it takes the time to get the video together, if it takes the time to edit, if it takes the time to email, if it takes the time to build an audience and that sort of thing. And I also make room for the understanding of, even if this is not my mindset, I also make room for the understanding of, Tachi, the people who the content isn't necessarily what they're passionate about, but the action, like, let's say if they're actresses, I'm just passionate about mm-hmm. acting. I don't care if I have to play a slave, if I have to play the crackhead or whatever. I just want to act or whatever. I get that.
And that's okay. That's okay. Because we don't hold, again, I understand it's different, but we don't say the same thing to people of other ethnicities. And, oh, well, you always have to play Rosa Parks being upright and fine, sitting in the back of the bus because you are black and you must uphold the right. We don't do that with anybody exactly. else. Can't you just be an actor or an actress and just act? I understand our position in society. And the answer is no, kind of. But at the same time, we are not a monolith. And at the same time, we're always fighting to be considered an actor as opposed to a black actor. So if that's the case, then we've got to start to let go of these conventions. And I get where it comes from. Again, we don't have enough of the counter narrative. But who am I again to tell you, if you just want to act and you want to flex your acting chops being a stripper, have at it. What do you want? What am I going to say?
Well, I know you guys are talking about like reality TV and the counter narrative. I really get tired of slave movies. I do.
And I'm sorry. I don't know.
I know, right? You know who I think because of every time I think of a slave movie, though? And me and my husband say this all the time. Like, Cicely Tyson was born old. Like, I have never...
She came out the womb 89.
Jane Pittman, yes.
I've been seeing her like, dang, Cicely Tyson, you like 200. And she's been 200 since I first saw her.
I think for me,
what was the last one with the young lady, 12 Years a Slave. I just couldn't bring myself to watch it. I get so tired. It's emotionally draining to see my people shackled and beat. Like, believe me, I get it. I'm very pro-black, as you know. Like, I'm kind of militant. I just don't want to go to bed mad. You know, you know what I mean? It's like, it's just very draining. And it's the other reason why I don't really watch Underground, because my mom calls me telling me about it and she's upset and tense. And she's like, oh, this scene episode made me cry. Like, it's great television and it's good storytelling. And it's authentic sort of, you know, situations and acting that I can respect and, you know, but like, I don't mind, you know, not talking about it. I think it is a counter narrative issue, as in we're not just slaves. We didn't go from just being slaves to drug dealers. Like, there's all sorts of, and strippers, where there's all sorts of people and stories to be told in between that, you know, it's like, okay, you're either in 12 Years a Slave or you're in Straight out of Compton. Like, That really bugs me.
Yeah, I think for me, I don't have a problem with the film, but again, it's a thing of we don't have anything to count again. You know what I mean? Like, you can put. I don't mind them. Like, I've seen them all, but I would like to see other things as well.
Outside of drug dealers, it's anytime a black movie is Oscar nominated, most of the time it's a slave, some type of slave movie.
Did you see Taraji?
At least Django made me laugh.
First of all, she was a little tipsy, but I ain't mad at my girl. When she accepted her award for Empire,
yeah,
and she was just kind of like, you know, I would have thought it would have been for this, but you know, who would have thought?
That's like when Denzel.
She was nominated for The Curious Case of Benjamin Button, and that was one of the most fascinating movies I've ever seen in my life. So fascinating. Yeah. Very well done. I mean, I felt like I was in like some, I don't know, I can remember just being in the movie and seeing just the experience of seeing that movie. Yeah. She was excellent in that movie. Like, that's like what she should have won for.
Denzel accepted the award for Training Day, and which would have never been, which shouldn't have been nominated. It was a good movie. I enjoyed it. But Training Day is not a movie that usually gets nominated at the Academy Awards. But it was the year they gave him, Halle, and Sidney Poitier an award. And Denzel, mm-hmm. he gets up there and he's like, I guess y'all killed two birds with one stone. He knew that you got Glory. You had every Denzel movie.
Malcolm X, Hurricane.
So while we know he deserved that Oscar, it was like, so we accepted that award for every other movie he had been in. It was like, okay.
Okay, y'all get it.
Why Halle Berry's non-acting self?
Because she was sleeping with Billy Bob Thornton. It was like if you saw Monsters Ball, like I remember the sex scene, and me and my friends looked at each other and was like, "Damn, she about to win this Academy Award for sleeping with this white man in this movie." Because but to go back to like the slave movies though, like me and a friend of mine, he teaches African studies, African American studies at the university. Like we were talking about slave movies and the sort, and it's really just porn for white people. Like these movies, like they watch these movies and they're like, and they get to see black people getting fucked up over and over and over and over again. And somebody's getting off to this. Somebody is getting off to this, some studio somewhere. But I create like this very 3-minute film called Racist White Boy Porn, where it's like the slave is hanging by an American flag. You know what I mean? Because that's what it comes down to.
You know,
I agree with that.
Darnell, that reminds me of Dave Chappelle and his act.
You said who?
It reminds me of Dave Chappelle's Africa trip and the impetus for that, for him doing that, and the difference being laughed at and being laughed at. You know what I mean?
It was amazing because, like, I was just talking about that because there are people, like, we were talking about Dave Chappelle, and somebody was like, "Oh, didn't he go crazy?" I was like, "No, I said he left because they tried to control him. It was like, here's 300 million, but we need to control what you do." And he was saying, you know, basically, at one point they were laughing with him, but then it was laughing at him, and he's like, "I couldn't tell the difference." You know what I mean? And that's what it was. Once they started all of that money, it was like, now we're laughing at you. And it became less about, I'm being funny. He's like, he started seeing people saying his lines in the street. And he was like, okay, it really means something else to you. I need to make a change. And which was like that moment in Black history where it was like, finally, somebody turned down $300 million and said, fuck the industry, I'm out.
I really appreciate what Dave Chappelle brought, though.
It was great. He was a genius.
He even through comedy, he brought a cultural conversation that everybody felt uncomfortable with having. Mm-hmm. And he made it funny, and he made it comfortable for us to be able to talk about some of these most challenging topics. Mm-hmm. Also the actor interview guy show. I don't know what show that is. CK, actor interview guy show.
Yeah.
Oh, was he on in the actor's studio?
What happened? Did Stephanie leave? It's all good. Go ahead. I think I know where she left.
Oh, Black Snake Moan, though. Oh, yeah, another film. You know, you had Samuel Jackson with the white girl on a leash in his house. You know what I mean?
I just get tired.
What happened? I miss.
I just can't. Some of these things, like, okay, between the Trump and I just can't. I just can't. So I just sigh every once in a while. You'll have to excuse me.
I hear you, but I mean, we definitely need better films and to tell our story, which is crazy because I remember when Viola Davis and it was actually, I don't remember who, it might have been Kerry Washington, but a few Black women from television and film were on a panel. And they were saying, you know, no one's telling the Black woman's story. They were like, well, why don't you do these? And it's funny because I know many Black women in LA and in the US who are writers and have Black women's stories to tell, but no one's produced, no one's giving money, and no one's greenlighting Black women's stories. And so it's not that we're not writing. And just like Nate Parker, I went to see, well, I hate to bring up Nate Parker's name, but before all this, before he became what he is, then, well, we knew, he came to LA to speak at the Pan-African Film Festival. And he was saying that no one, he was like, you know, I would like to produce more Black films, but nobody's writing them. And I'm sitting there like, I got 10 scripts I've been trying to shoot. Like, and everybody in there at least had 5 scripts between them. You know what I mean? And it's like, no, we have them. We have films that these folks aren't going to give us money for and aren't going to put out there. So we have to put it out there. You see it on YouTube and you hear about it like 5 years later of how good it is, but no one will ever know. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. So what do you think about, hold up. Sorry, my daughter's laying down on my feet. So what do you think about, will you talk about, oh, wake up better, watch, Kente is about to come on in 2 minutes. He told me to wait for him for 2 minutes. So after he come on, then I'll get you on, Aaron. All right. So what do you think about in the context of, this is one of the things that we were talking about the other night. We were talking about superheroes. You remember this, Tachi? So we were talking about superheroes and we keep having all of these different superhero characters. And one of the things that came up was Riri Williams. And Riri Williams is going to be the new Iron Man. It's a Black chick. They haven't been the... It's a new one, but it's not a new one. And one of the things... One of my things with... It's not that I don't want to see a Black woman be Iron Man. I think it's cool for a Black woman to be a superhero. It's just like, I just want chick to have her own story. So, and I bet that there's people out there writing those stories.
They have been.
People out there telling that stories. Mm-hmm. Oh, and this is the other question I wanted to ask both of you, actually. When you talk about Black women writers, producers, and that sort of thing. So how y'all feel about Shonda Rhimes?
You go first.
Okay, for me, like I get it. I get the show. I get it. I haven't watched in many seasons. I think I watched the first season of Scandal. I was the hospital show. I was a fan of Grey's Anatomy. I was a fan of that. I saw the first half of the first season of How to Get Away with Murder. They're not for me, but I get that they are, that the writing is good, and I get that the story is good. I just wish that they were different. At least I stopped watching Scandal when I realized that they were never going to give the Black man a storyline, and no Black man on the show had a storyline, but I knew everything about every other character on the show. And I was like, I don't know what this is supposed to mean. The Black man has no place in society. Am I reaching? I don't know what's happening. I need to stop watching. And so I just stopped watching. And then they were, and I worked, so the network I worked for ABC. And I was on an elevator with her, and I was like, Shonda, you know, are you going to give the Black guy a story? She's like, oh, we saved the best for last. And then they end up killing him like 3 seasons later, and he still had no story. And so I'm like, okay, so he had no purpose. And the only other Black man on there until her father showed up was the man she was sleeping with while she was fantasizing about the white dude. So I just had to stop watching. But I get it. I get why people watch it. I get why people say it's good. It's just not for me.
Kente, you want to chime in?
About Shonda Rhimes?
Yeah.
I don't watch her stuff. It's definitely nothing I would be remotely interested in watching. And like I said on the last show, I'm not just happy. I'm not one of those black folks who are just happy that black people are on television. I think we're way beyond that. We have to actually fight for quality. And so, you know, I mean, it's cool that a sister, you know, has a position in Hollywood, but, you know, definitely that's not, I'm not the target audience. So.
Mm-hmm. Tachi?
Exactly.
Let me just add for the both of you, and this may not be a thing. Are we talking specifically about Scandal, or are we talking about her entire?
I'm talking about the catalog.
You're talking about
the catalog. And the other one. How to Get Away with Murder.
Okay.
He did Being Mary Jane too, right?
No.
No, Being Mary Jane was Mara and Brock Akil, but they're no longer on that anymore. It's now passed on to I can't remember her name.
Okay.
Yeah. I think that she is a fantastic writer. I think she has stories that engage. Here's the thing. I think that part of too much of the expectation is always to have a black story with no presence of anybody else in there. And that's not simply the case when you live in the world. I think there's a lot of saltiness at the fact that she was sleeping with the president and he happens to be white. There's this whole thing, and I'm not saying this is the two of you, but there's this whole thing that seems to come up whenever it comes to something like that. She's just being fetishized. Fetishized. Oh, he just sees her as the black XYZ. So sees her in a more sexual way. And why does she have to be basically the concubine when, you know, there are all other types of positive characteristics that, for example, I'm talking about Scandal now, positive characteristics that Olivia Pope has, but that's the one thing people choose to focus on. I'm like, are black women that unlovable that nobody else could see us as desirable? Because when you make those arguments, that's exactly what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's kind of a point of contention for some people. It's like there probably would not be this much of a stink if it was the other way around. So that's one thing. I think she writes stories for everybody, and that's okay. If you're a black writer, it does not dictate that you have to write black stories only. So there may be black people in your stories. There may be no black people in your stories, because guess what? You're a writer, not just a black writer. So you may be informed, or your writing may be informed by a particular point of view or your standpoint, Rasheem standpoint theory. It may be informed by that, but that doesn't mean that's all you are. That doesn't mean that you can't write sci-fi and there are no black characters. Now, do I feel you have a responsibility? Somewhat. Let me speak for me. I would want to see that level of diversity if I'm doing that. But at the same time, I don't think it has to be required, because we don't hold other writers to that same standard.
Yeah.
So I think we're holding her to an impossible standard that you don't hold other writers to. Not you.
And I feel that. I think for me, just about that, I think for me is that if you're going to to do character development on every other character, I need it done for the black person too. And that was my only issue with Scandal anyway. I watched Grey's Anatomy and I wasn't displeased by that. I was a fan until I thought it wasn't going to come back on the air. But that was my only thing. But it's not for me. It's not a show that I can watch because I'm not her audience.
So, Kente, I want you to read Aaron's question and go ahead and respond to it, because I saw you got a big smile when you read it, it looked like, unless you're doing multitasking.
If the president were black and he was fucking a white woman, what would he be said? No, that's not what I was laughing at, but but I don't know. I think we've always felt like white men could always do whatever the fuck they want. So it wouldn't, that's not, you know what I'm saying? Like, white men have always had privilege to rape and molest and do whatever the hell they want. So I think it's a different, it's not saying the same thing, I don't think. But honestly, I don't like it either way. So, you know, but I'm, you know.
Do you not like the Shonda Rhimes stuff, or are you just
talking about it? I'm just not a fan of her stuff. I've seen a little bit of Grey's Anatomy, didn't care for it. She's just not, I'm not the person that she writes to, you know? So I'm really a bad person to look at her work. I just don't like that kind of stuff. I like the sister that does Power. I think she's really good. She's a talented writer.
What's her name?
Her name is, help me out. I usually can just say it like that. Whatever her name is.
I know.
She's good. But like I said, I'm not one of those black people that's just happy to see black people on television. So, sometimes I'd rather see none of us than some old janky shit.
Right. Amen.
What's her name? Oh my God.
I'm trying to look it up, but I could. I'm
trying to remember and I can't.
If anybody can think of it, please type it in the chat so we can at the very least say her name.
Oh my God. Her name is like, that's going to bother the hell out of me. And she's really talented too.
So, Brandon, tell me somebody while we're looking for her name. Or were you done, Kente?
I'm done. Oh, Courtney Kemp.
Okay.
She used to work on The Good Wife. Okay.
Courtney Kemp. Okay, okay, okay.
But now what were you going to say, Rasheem?
Well, one of the questions I wanted to ask is there somebody that you like out there right now? Tell me who you like in terms of director, television shows, media.
Oh, Ryan Coogler is awesome. Ava DuVernay-Smith is awesome as well. They're brilliant. I mean, they're really talented at what they do. They, visually, they're really good writers. He's a really good writer, for example, and great storyteller. Those two, for example, are amazing. And there's, I think Darnell and Tachi knows this, but there's a lot of really good black directors on television. Some of the best directors on television are black. You have the brother that used to be on Homicide, Clark Johnson, who's one of the top directors in television. For a while, he was the guy they would bring in to do the pilots because he was he's amazing. He's, you have him. I mean, you have Ernest Dickerson, who came from Spike Lee.
Yes.
He's amazing. There's so many great, talented Seth Mann, who I had the pleasure to interview on my show. He's a really good director. So there's a lot of talented cats out there in the game. And a lot of people don't know, like a lot of TV. Well, I shouldn't say a lot because you can always have more. Right. But more than people would realize work in television for sure. The guy who did the movie Red Tails, his name is like Anthony Hemingway.
Yeah. He's great too. He does a lot of work with some of the like independent folks out here too, who are trying to get their stuff off the ground. He just worked with a friend of mine for a show that he was trying to pitch. And so like a lot of the black directors that are working for these television shows and these films are also still very connected with the community and saying, listen, if you need help, I got you. And which is good because you don't hear about a lot of them because I don't know if no one's talking about it or they just not putting it out there. But like you said, there are a lot.
Mm-hmm. There's The Wire. I know they had a lot of black directors on that show and some of them gone on to do stuff. I believe the show Lost had like three black directors on that worked on that show as well. So they were, you got to give them credit because a lot of these shows, you don't see black people really behind the scenes like you would hope, So it was really, it's pretty awesome.
Well, one of the things I appreciate about all of the people that you guys mentioned is just a demonstration that every time a Black director or what have you is on a project, it's not that he's doing a Black show or the cast is going to be all Black. Like, we're versatile. Try us out. You know?
Yeah. One of the really good directors out there right now is the brother who did the movie Equalizer, Antoine Fuqua.
Yeah, Antoine Fuqua is fantastic.
Really good. I think it's like first movie that he really got was that, what's that one that he did with the, I think it was the Chow Yun Fat in it. Back in the day, he did like a movie. Oh, what was the name of that movie? It was like an action movie, but it wasn't like a Black movie at all. Yeah.
I'm not old like you, Kente, so I'm just kidding.
Kente, you see how Tachi y'all glammed up today? You don't see the hat. You see how she got...
No, but she's always glamorous.
Today is a media scope day.
She had a show today or something, so you know what I mean? Got to get on her level.
Equalizer, hot man. You know, the thing about Equalizer, I really liked it, but you know, the brother who goes on a warpath for the afflicted white girl storyline is, you know, makes my stomach curl.
You don't like that type of thing?
No, too, I don't like it. It's like he's gonna destroy the Russian mob over this white girl. You know,
maybe, you know.
He took that's the only thing cool about it. This one brother destroyed the whole Russian mob and went to Russia and killed, like, god dang. Like, wow, we need him to take out some of these white supremacists. Where's he at?
Oh my god.
Exactly.
Like, man. But I enjoyed the movie most, you know, for the most part.
Yeah.
Yeah, Hollywood though is a trip though, because it, you know, Hollywood is reinforces negative stereotypes, and it basically keeps this stuff going on. So I've talked about this before, about this this study they did that white males, 12, the age of 12, when they watch television, their self-esteem goes up. Whereas Black boys at, you know, at the same age, watching the same stuff, they had lower self-esteem, which, you know, just thinking about it, right? You know, you can figure that's probably true. But if you think about it, when you watch TV, like, you know, Superman is white, Batman is white, you know, James Bond is white.
I will tell you this. This is a little anecdote story, mm-hmm. but this really, I feel like, illustrates a little bit of how the power of television in terms of what you're talking about, KJ. Mm-hmm. So my daughter goes to a particularly like a super diverse school. When I say I'm diverse, I'm not just meaning Black and white, or like it's people from all over the country that, you know, all over the world, I shouldn't say country, all over the world that go to her school. So I was on her playground one day, and one of the kids was playing with my neighbor's son. My neighbor's son is Black. This other kid is white. When the kid was playing at their house, they were watching, I think Roots was on its series where it was on. So the kids had, you know, watched some parts of it. So they go outside to play, and I'm just going to say Bobby. Bobby's like, they're like, okay, let's do Roots. Like, I'm going to be Kuta Kinte. And the Black boy, Bobby's white. The Black boy's like, you can't be Kuta Kinte. Kuta Kinte is Black. And he's like, but they're both fighting to be Kuta Kinte because Kuta Kinte is the protagonist of the story. He's the main person in the story. He's the hero. He prevails. And at this time that somebody trying to tell him that this character, he can't be this character because they don't have the same, he doesn't care. None of that at this time, none of this matters. He wants to be the superhero. And I felt like that was such a great illustration in my mind for how our children come up and it's just like, I want to be Superman. You know, I want to be that. And you know, Jamera's telling him, dude, Kinte, Kuta Kinte, not you Kinte, Kuta Kinte is Black. You can't be. And he was like, I don't understand why I can't be why I can't be him. And he was just, you know, steadily trying to explain to him. And I think that's just a good illustration of how these protagonists, and when you have certain protagonists dominating the airwaves, kids just want to be the protagonist. You give him all the great attributes, make them the best person. So kids want to be whoever the protagonist, whoever the hero is. They don't care. You know, they're not making that connection that this person is a different color than me. So,
you know, hey, but hey, they can be, you can be Hancock. We'll give him that one.
Hancock?
Yeah. The alcoholic superhero, Will
Smith. Oh. Lame superhero character. Other than the Panther. Thank you, computer. I'm excited about the Panther. I told y'all about that.
Yes.
Black Panther, yeah.
Yeah, I'm excited about that too.
Well, I'm looking forward to that.
Because Ryan Coogler is the truth. When I seen Fruitvale Station, I was like, man, this guy is really, really talented.
Man, I was so, because I was already invested in the story of Oscar Grant. So when Fruitvale came out, they gave us screening copies. So I had some friends over and we watched it on the projector. And I think the last 15 minutes until like 45 minutes after, we were all just silent. Like nobody could speak. I was like, wow. this guy is gonna go. One, the story itself, but then the way he made it happen, it felt like you were watching your cousin in this movie. And, you know, it was crazy.
I mean, this guy is talented, like really talented.
Yeah,
so many levels. And, even the Rocky movie he did. Creed.
Creed.
Because I was like, when I first heard about it, I was like, Rocky again.
Yeah, I was the same way. I was like, let's leave Rocky alone.
But, you know, I liked the switch that he did on it, you know. So, the guy's super talented. I can't wait for the next, you know, he got Black Panther coming out and whatever else he does. If he does a home video, I want to see it. You know, so, yeah, he's dope, man. He's really good.
Yeah,
man. Nothing different.
McQueen, too. I like Steve McQueen.
Oh, yeah.
I really appreciate his work. I think the first one I saw was the one about the sex act. I forget the name.
Bullet.
Which one was
it? No, I said Bullet.
Oh. And then Hunger, and then 12 Years a Slave. Like, his directing, I think, is really great. Mm. Yeah. He does like a lot of little independent things that people don't like. He just releases in like art galleries sometimes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
Steve McQueen, yeah. Mm. I remember when I first heard about it, I was like, I thought he was dead.
Right. I was like, I said, the white man?
oh, like the designer.
Oh, man.
I've been checked out. Yeah, very talented. We're fortunate, though, that there are, you know, there's people out there that are very talented, but hopefully, well, they, you know, get that opportunity to really show their talent, because, you know, like I always tell people, I live, I'm in Los Angeles. There's no shortage of talented people here, but yeah. Will they get that opportunity? Because that's what everybody really wants at the end of the day, is an opportunity, just to, you know, sink or swim, you know?
Yeah, that's it.
So, that's all we want.
Right. So that's what's up. I mean, we had our HBCU show. We did our HBCU after show. We started talking about Black people in film. I got to find a way to chop up this video for YouTube so I could chop up the first part where it was HBCU on this section and then do the next one. If not, I'm just going to publish the whole thing and be like, go at this section. We start talking about Black people in media. But if there's anything else that you guys want to add within the context of what we're talking about, then let's have that conversation. Then I'm probably going to shut it down in about 15 minutes. But anything that you think that we haven't covered as it relates to that, I will tell you what I'm interested in seeing. And I mentioned this last time. I would like to see more Octavia Butler books be more. I would like to see any Octavia Butler book be turned into a movie. I would like to see more of our books be turned into movies, period. I'm always seeing other people doing it, and I have not read or seen a better sci-fi writer. than Octavia Butler. The closest maybe that come to it is homegirl who did The Matrix, who you interviewed, Kente?
Sophia Stewart.
Sophia?
Mm-hmm.
Sophia Stewart. But mm-hmm. I would like to see more of that. And that's already a story that's already written, you know?
Mm-hmm. Oh, I would love mm-hmm. it too, you know, but, you know, once again, once anything material gets in the Hollywood popcorn machine, you never know what's going to come out of it. So, you know, like I used to get real excited, like, especially with Black stuff, like I would get excited. I'd be like, oh man, they're going to do a story about such and such. And then, you know, probably the point where I just said, I have no longer no faith was the movie Rosewood. I was like, once when that came out, I was like through. I was just like, no, I gotta see. I'm like, you know how they say innocent until proven guilty? It's like they're guilty until proven guilty.
You gotta prove to me.
Yeah, I don't get excited no more with Hollywood stuff until it comes out. So, and then it's like, okay, that was good, you know? So,
yeah.
I know, but I'm crusty though.
I do want to see more, and they exist, but just not on a wider scale or in the public eye. So we have Ava DuVernay, and everybody's all over Ava, because she's fantastic. Maybe. But then it's still a boys' club. Let's be real and let's be honest. I would love to see more Black women directors, more Black, because we're in film school. You know, and we're doing those things. So there needs to be more of that. If we're talking about representation, we need to look at representation all the way around. It's not just enough. Yeah, we're all Black. Yeah, okay. But if some of us are getting squashed, then it's not equality. So we really need to look at having all of us equally represented behind the camera as well.
Yeah. Oh, you just hit something. You were here when we did the topic role and we talked about Matt Damon's comment about behind the camera.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because
you said that, mm-hmm. I just started thinking about that whole Matt Damon comment about we don't need diversity behind the camera. Why is that important?
Oh,
in his world, he can save the Great Wall of China.
Right.
I can see why he doesn't want it.
Yeah. Why is that important?
Because it calls your mediocrity into question. Anytime there's a question of we need this, it's because for so long, not him in particular, but for so long, the mainstream has slid on mediocrity. You don't really have to be very good when you're guaranteed X, Y, Z. So now that there are people who are good and they just also happen to be diverse, it's like, oh, well, damn, now my fraud is going to be discovered.
Right.
If you do what you're supposed to do in the first place and you come with excellence, you don't have anything to worry about.
I think the fact that we're having so many sequels and reboots and redos of stuff is...
It's because there's a lack of diversity. If the same 14 people...
No new ideas. There's like no new ideas being brought to the table, or we're letting people in the room, but they're not getting the voice at the table. Like we just regurgitating information.
Well, let's make another Jumanji. Yes, at this time we'll have Kevin Hart and The Rock.
You know how many times, like how many Supermans, how many Batmans, we could tell that story 15 different times without telling. Now we're excited now because it's a Black Panther, right? And like that's ridiculous that. We could tell Superman's story over and over again 1,500 times, and this is the, you know what I mean? I mean, other than Blade, we had Blade for a minute.
Wait a minute, I got a call. This one was different because it was Batman versus Superman. See, now that's when
you know what? I'm going to hurl a tomato at you. There was a question that came up in the chat. Chad Eckert wanted to know, what do you think of Empire?
Yeah, what do you guys think of Empire?
I don't watch it.
I'm definitely not the demographic for that. No, Lee Daniels is involved. No,
you know, I did like Paperboy though, surprisingly, the Lee Daniels movie. That's the only thing I've liked by him, but yeah, that's it.
I watched the first season. It seemed like it was an ongoing music video.
God bless you.
Right?
You were able to sit through it.
And so that was interesting that it was an ongoing music video. I think that there is a market for certain stereotypes, and I think that fed that market. You know, as we said before, I think that there are people in all of those in different demographics that exists. And that's about the nicest I could put that.
There's room in the space for those types of stories. Those people exist. Absolutely. Come on now. How many rappers do we know that that's their story for real? So that does exist again.
They're all suing them saying it's their story. So apparently.
What? Exactly. 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 This is them. So it happens in real life. The only thing is, again, I will say there's not a counter narrative with other stories that point to the diverse nature of Black people, so that when you see an empire in Korea, if it's there, or this is what you think Black American life is like, and that's where the problem lies. I think it's difficult because it's hard sometimes for us to. It's very difficult for us to get past the stereotypical nature of the situation, of the characters, of their behavior. It's difficult. But at the root of it, if you look at it and you inserted another family, or if they were a different ethnicity, would you be as anti-empire as you are now? I mean, and that might be the case, but could it be just the case of looking at it as another stereotypical story with another stereotypical Black family? But if you erase that and you make them an Irish family.
If they were an Irish family, then they wouldn't be stereotypical Black. And what I mean by that is that it's not just their skin that's making them Black. Their presence, their representing, their language, their movement, the way they interact, like they're bringing all of that to it. And it's not that I have a problem with it in and of itself. Like, especially individually, I love the actors. I think they're phenomenal. I think they're really, actually really good actors. The guys on there who sing can really actually sing. I don't know about that dude who rap. He kind of like, you know what I mean? He kind of whack. But anyway.
The one that used to work at Kentucky Fried Chicken. I don't know.
The one with the
or wherever you were. Hakeem.
He can't really rap. That ain't skills. I know what skills are. That ain't skills. But anywho.
She knows what skills are.
I do know what skills are, and that is not skills.
Right.
But I think what I'm looking at it as when I look at it is I'm looking at it in the context of other things, right? I'm looking at it in It's being held up. It's like when, what was that movie that has that song? Anyway, the song is what I'm going to focus on. When that song got the, whatever the award, I don't know if it was Academy Award, Hard Out Here for a Pimp.
Oh, Hard Out Here for a Pimp from Terrence Howard and Taraji.
All the things that we have created that is a demonstration of beauty, of culture, of us, I wouldn't have a problem with Hard Out Here for a Pimp getting an award. That's the
greatest moment in Black history.
No, that was the greatest coonery.
Obviously, I'm being very serious.
No, the problem is that the Oscar, well, in some awards are so subjective, it's like whatever. But in many people's eyes, the Oscar is the pinnacle of success for for the film industry. And so for the fact the film and entertainment, so the fact that you won one for this, to me is actually an abomination, because as you said, there are 10 million other more beautiful, forget about the pictures, let's talk about the songs. 10 million, more beautiful things, more beautiful pieces of music that have come out of Black films. And this is what you choose to give an Oscar. But again, why are we surprised? We keep acting surprised at these things. Look who sits on the Academy. So until you have more of a diverse Academy with people who vote not just from their narrow point of view, this is what you continue to have. Now, they've started to make some changes in terms of diversity, but it's still not going to erase how many years of misvoting because I don't understand what they're trying to say, so I'm just not going to vote.
No, you know what I love about Tachi? You are such an optimist. You just,
How is that optimistic?
You think they're just going to change and fix it and everything's it's never going. That's what they're trying to do, is put that out.
But if you listen to what I said, what I said was, though they're trying to make some changes, that doesn't mean that it's going to do anything.
They'll put somebody black on there who thinks just like them. They'll be chocolate clever white supremacists. So what difference will it make? They'll just find Negroes to vote like they want them to vote. And they'll say, then they'll justify it by saying, half the panel's black. So what are you complaining about? So I think our solution is to create our own stuff.
You say that, Kente. Here's the thing. When you say that, and here's some of my challenges too. I feel like I'm constantly having to explain, and it's like I'm almost tired of explaining the need for black space and the need for black critique, because people don't understand, like, we're not being represented or we're being misrepresented in other spaces. And so when you hold up something like this is like Hard Out Here for a Pimp is the pinnacle, right, of what we could do. You award this, and that's not representative of what any of us think is, it should be given an accolade. So then we're in a situation where it's like we either knock down, it's like the old age question, actually. Do we knock down their door to beg, could you please let me have a seat at your table so that I could tell you how do you do this and blah, blah? Or do we say, you know what? I see that you have your own agenda and it does not include, you do not want my opinion. You do not care about my culture or my values or my perspective. We're going to create a space where my culture and my values are respected. And I don't think people get that. I think a lot of times when we create black spaces for voices and for self-critique and self-evaluation without anybody else's gaze, it's looked at as, counter-racism.
Separatist.
But it's like, I'm not in those spaces. And I am tired of knocking on your door asking you to hear my voice.
So here's the thing, and I totally agree, and I'm always with it. I'm like, well, stop begging people who don't want you around to be at their table, because your table is probably nasty anyway. Form your own table. How the hell ever? When you say that, you have to be prepared for the fact that this is not going to be riches, and how many people are willing to say, all right, well, I'm not going to make the XYZ because of the... Honestly, how many people are willing to do that? That's why it hasn't happened now. Like you were saying, Darnell, it's about credit and I'm going to need this $1,000. And I get it, but are you willing to also have another job and let this be your side thing until we're able to? And a lot of people aren't able to do it. So when we say we want to start our own, you have to be all invested. And that includes not making a lot for or anything for a long time if you believe in the project. And I just don't think there are enough of us that are invested in that.
Yeah, well, to be honest with you, I mean, how many black actors are really making money anyway?
Right, but they're making more than like $50 for showing up. They're making more than craft services. So, and again, we're really only talking about a small handful of people. For all the black people that are actually making money, making something in Hollywood, there are so many others who are not. So we're now talking about them in terms of, I still need to keep a day job of some sort. This cannot be my full gig because I need to survive. So we need to understand that it may not be profitable for a very long time. And I don't know how many people are prepared to roll with that.
I'm agreeing with you. I'm saying the reason why you should think along those lines is you ain't doing shit anyway. So you might as well do shit. I'm actually right there with you. I'm right there with you, Kachi, on that one. So it's like, I'd rather struggle for my own hustle than for somebody else's. So, so that's where I'm at. And you know, it just it's gonna take a new way of thinking. You know, but I think one of our biggest problems is that we want validation too, and you, that's the thing is. Black folks really want that white validation. They want massa just to put their arms around them and say, "You done good. You done good. You did a great job. You slept with Big Boy in the movie. You did a great job. Here's an award. Here's a you played Mammy in what's that movie? You did a wonderful job. You did great. You get this wonderful award. You won't work again." Or anything substantial, or your career ain't gonna go anywhere. But here you go. Here's an award. You're validated. And once we get to a point where we don't need the validation like that, and we can, you know, seek validation from within, which may never happen. You know, I may be 90 years old and still be talking the same shit. But you know, I mean, it is what it is. So, you know. So, but I love Tachi because Tachi's the optimist, and. I really believe that in Tachi's gonna make it happen.
I'm an optimist for some types of things, but not everything.
I wish I could be like Tachi. Seriously, I would be like Tachi when I grow up.
Well, stop the nonsense.
All right, y'all. I'm about to wrap it up. There's still people on here, so they might have liked something that you said. They might think you're super dope and cool. Could you let them know how to get, I got another acronym, y'all. Can you let them know how to get swift with you? So that means if you gotta, I know I just be making stuff up. Why not? Oh, if you have a Snapchat, a website, an Instagram, a Facebook, and a Twitter, or a Twitter, let them know how they can get swift to keep up with you. Darnell, you wanna go first?
All right, darnellwalker.com, D-A-R-N-E-L-L, walker.com. I'm on Instagram. As Clever Bastard, and that's me.
You're not on Twitter?
Oh yeah, I am on Twitter. I don't really tweet though, so ain't no point in even following me there. But if you go on there, Skinny Genius, that's me.
Hilarious.
All right, Kente.
All right, you can find me on Twitter where I do tweet actually. At Kente F, K-I-N-T-E-F. And also you can go to indyradio.org. That's indyradio.org. Thank you for having me as always. And nice to meet you, Darnell. It's the first time I get up. And that's my dance instructor, Tachi. I can't wait for everything to get started.
Okay.
All right. And thank you, of course, Rasheem.
Absolutely. Kente, I am also a co-host on Kente's show, the Mars and Venus show. And that is, we're kicking that off September 12th for which season is this?
This is season 4 of the show. Friend Zone.
It's a podcast, and that show is going to be on the Friend Zone.
Which Rasheem has put many of men in over her years, I'm sure.
You know what? I got to do it to make up for Darnell because I had a big crush on Darnell and Darnell rejected me. So ever since then, I just been putting dude, look at Aaron. I've been making all men pay. All right.
So I am at Tachiada, T-A-C-H-I-A-D-A on all platforms. That's Snapchat, Periscope, Busker, Twitter. I'm on everything, basically. And chatachi.me, C-H-E-T-A-C-H-I, my real name, is my website. So, yes, and I live stream to like 3 times a week.
Awesome sauce. I am Rasheem, the host of The Counter Narrative. You can find me right here where some of you are if you are here in the if you're right here in the live stream section. If you are not here and you are watching the video, you can find me on Twitter at s.rasheem. On Facebook, I'll be at Rasheem. You can also find the replays of the show at srasheem.com and everything just look for me at s.rasheem. It's not shouldn't be too many of those out there. Is there anything else I want to say? There is what is the next show? There's another show coming up. The next show is Black LGBT and Friday. I'm smiling because, you know, Kente.
That's
favorite. Yes, his favorite. Black LGBT, race, gender, and sexual orientation. That's Friday. Coming up in a few days. It'll be at 9:30 p.m. This is where we'll have the pre-show and the after show for that show. And if you want to know where to get direct tickets to that event, the free event, you could just scroll down under where you see me now here. And if not, you can just go to firetalk.com/Rasheem. I gotta get used to doing this, right? Like in a more concise way.
Wait a minute, the tickets are free. Why did I have to pay?
Say that again. Why did you have to pay? You know what I mean? First time, first timers. So thank you for everybody for being here. Go ahead and do roll call. Park Pet Place, thank you for showing up. Anonymous, I appreciate it. I like your profile pic too. s.rasheem, I'm going to thank myself because I am worthy. Chad Eckerd, aka Uncle Bert. Tachi, thank you for coming on. I always love having you. Darnell Lamont Walker, the first guy who broke my heart. What's up? And put every guy in a friend zone. Colorful Jamie, thank you for being here. Pat Durham Skywriter. Oh my gosh, my chat thing is not letting me move. Wake Up Better, aka Aaron. Sun and Sand. Can you guys see when other people subscribe to?
No.
It's not at all. So when I say it, it just sounds crazy. Okay. It pops up on my screen when somebody new subscribed. Want to make sure I say hey to everybody. So Steph, of course. So Steph is she is a co-host. She is a host. I guess you could say she's the host and I'm the co-host of Hers, Mine, and Yours. We're on a show coming up. And the topic is creating girlfriend relationships, like friend, grown women friends, as got to clarify for Kente's sake. So if I say hello to everybody, if I didn't say your name, please charge it to the computer and not to me. It won't let me scroll down and see everybody's name. But thank you for everybody for coming out. Good night.
Peace.
Good night. Peace.